I request everyone to put their mobile phones on silent mode and let us put a lot of energy in the entire conference and make the maximum benefit of you know, very good quality of people we are having at the conference. Definitely, and start with the aim that we want to get the best out of the solar assets our country has. So, three cheers for the solar assets our country already have. The format of the conference will be, in the beginning we'll have presentations of 10 minutes or speech by each speaker, and then we'll have the panel discussion moderated by Ma'am Monica Rathi, who is Head of Business Development EPC at Mahindra Susten. So with this I invite Mr. Reddy to give the opening address, and then Ma'am Monica Rathi to moderate and further steer away the session. Let's welcome Mr. Reddy from Adani with a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Challenge like no other. A journey that will reshape the future of energy. Megastructures, India's solar power.
Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. That was Adani Green for you. I am Wing Commander GRN Reddy. Happened to join Adani Green just 6 months back. Looking after the O&M part of it. I have 9 solar sites under me with a portfolio of 340 megawatts. I'm the cluster head of Karnataka state northern region. Today's presentation I'll be covering under these heads. First I'll talk about a brief about my company, the O&M philosophy that we follow, a brief comparative study, the challenges and the opportunities which exist in O&M, and before I conclude, a few recommendations, suggestions. This is it. As on date I stand before you, we have already commissioned 1778 megawatts of solar energy, and under the still under implementation is 230. That should meet our target of 2 gigawatts by this financial year end, and we are span over 9 states, 23 sites as on date. Additionally, we also have a facility of 1.2 gigawatt of module manufacturing facility at Mundra. Our core competency, as you see, stands with O&M. However, projects is also catching up because the kind of projects that we're implementing, and this is a bit old data, so you can expect more from this in the from the project side as well. Coming to the complexity, as of now, as I said, within a short span of another 1 to 2 years, we look for 2 to 2.5 gigahertz, and number of sites as on date is 23. A wide plethora of technology, right from thin film modules to string inverters to seasonal tilt, robotic cleaning, and 9 states, as I said. And the plant size invariably varies from 10 megawatts to 648. Or the Kamuti plant which you recently saw. That was primarily 45 minutes of National Geography video made for our company. This is the O&M philosophy that we follow. Operations, as you are aware, primarily takes care of the day-to-day activities and maintenance, schedule maintenance and plant activities. I'll be dwelling upon this slide later on. O&M happens to be the source of value creation for the business. Revenues we need to increase by increasing the power of generation. And coming to cost cutting, primarily O&M happens to be cost cutting. We have a manpower which is on the roll as well as off roll. We try to have lean mean force as possible, and cost being effectiveness and, you know, management of materials, services and resources with a proper forecasting scheduling, and my work at CapEx to be as efficient as possible. We have a central team and our head office is located in Ahmedabad, and presently there are 3 regions. We intend to have the 4th region east, where we are not available right now to a great extent, and with the help, they are the experts sitting there, and they help us in, you know, they are domain experts who look after HV side, LV side, low voltage inverters, especially on SCADA, switchyard, who assist the field units, the local sites, and through our renewable operations nerve center. This is the main crux of the thing which I am going to discuss with you. which we are coming up in a big way. Right now, we are in a very short, it's in a small scale. The operating model, when it comes to the site versus the central team which assists us from the background, most of the operations take place at the site with, of course, support from the head office, where a lot of management, knowledge management takes place, the forecasting, scheduling, insurance, the warranty claims, the space management and the standardization of the space as such, generating reports, revenue management, command and control structure as a whole. These activities outsourced is under the close supervision of the on-roll manpower. Like primarily there are three parts of it, like the grass cutting, the module cleaning part, and in case there happens to be seasonal tilt, the tilting of the modules. And the non-core activities like the module, as I said, securities and admin are primarily outsourced to a third party. The Renewable Operations Nerve Center, as I said, is still in the nascent phase, and we intend to come out in a big way at the Gandhigram, at a Shantigram office in Gandhigram, Gandhinagar, sorry. This is how it's going to look like, and because technology is there and we are above, it's possible for us to have a micro, right, going up to the module level, string monitoring, everything is possible, so that we have lean force at the site itself, and the head office can always assist in the to the site personnel. The value proposition of RONC is something like this. You know, you can have a lot of integration as it is possible, and information in real time, and how it is possible to even disseminate that on the mobile app. I'll be dwelling on that. I'll show you a snapshot. And generating real time alerts to the user. As there is a particular fault, you can go and attend to it. So there's a minimum wastage of time during the especially peak generation hours in the daytime. And analytics predicts. Intelligence can be integrated into that, and any intervention which is required at the site, any help, can be easily extended from the head office. This is a screenshot of your mobile app that we propose, wherein you have real time as to how, what was the generation, what is the irradiation, including the weather factors, what is the particular module, inverters, how they are behaving. It's possible to have all this on the app. This is the structure that I was talking about, the zones. Except for the east, north, west, south. And in, I just giving you an example of Karnataka, where the north Karnataka, I have 9 plants under me. There's another south cluster and a central one. This is basically for the ease of administration. If I were to compare a solar park with an individual site, because of a vast portfolio that we have, my personal feeling has been that it's easy to maintain a solar park. When the ecosystem is so supportive, the knowledge sharing is there. The power evacuation is not much of a problem because you have your own competitors and you know they can help you out. The optimization of resources is there. Unlike in a isolated site where you have to, you're more or less stretched. The regulatory body, the agency, they know what they are supposed to do. The month May or the month end when you have the joint meter reading, it's easy for us to conduct it. Unlike example from Karnataka where I say there are two agencies. One is the KPTCL and another is the DISCOM. So you need to get both of them on board, and together they have to come and do, and this kind of issues are there, admin issues primarily. And thus, if you see the photograph that I'm showing you below is the solar, ultra solar park of Gani. This is the one on the left. If you see, it's a contiguous land. However, when it comes to single sites, there are far more issues. When you start, we think that we'll get a contiguous land, but it doesn't happen that way. So there are pockets of land. So this itself is a big hassle and bottlenecks in itself. So that's what I want to convey, and of course the PPA in solar would be less, as I said, because of inherent advantages. Another comparison between a central to a string inverter. When it comes to a string inverters, basically we have 2-3% of, which is what we have found, is generation is more. The availability of a string inverter is more because it's a high availability. And the MTDBF, if I got to talk to the mean time between repair and availability of the modular concept, basically, I can go ahead and replace it as and when I want it. So not only that, even the switching on and shutdown of the MTT of a central inverter, correction, string inverter is 30 minutes more. So I get to generate more because of that. Of course, auxiliary consumption is less, primarily because not only is this string inverter less expensive, but I can also afford to have a spares as a spare in a standby at my site. So in our case, as we have a cluster base, we also have it in cluster. So wherever it's required, we can just go ahead and it's a module replacement sort of thing. However, the disadvantage would be the monitoring is difficult. If I have to go to each inverter at particular site, the thousands of them would be there. But notwithstanding, because of the communications, the SCADA and OFC which we laid, it's possible to monitor where it's going to go, likely to go faulty or where it's faulty and can replace them. And next is the, once the warranty lapses, what about the OEM? If you were to stop particular model production or something like that, then that is an issue. And long-term effect, as we all know, it's a recently new evolving field, 25 years, who's seen that, so that could be a challenge. It all boils down to how you're going to use your innovative methods, or if I were to say Jugaad, or how you're going to go about reducing the O&M costs. So whether it's module killing, whether you're going to use a robotic arm, the water, which kind of technique you're going to use, how you're going to bring the cost down. The weather monitoring station we have, how are you going to effectively utilize that to predict your next day's weather or the today's generation, or how much could I have generated? The thermography, I'm going to show you a few more slides on this. The PV analysis, as you are aware, already there people are there who are, I mean, the module, this is based on mobile ones. You can come and do the checking at site, so you know how the degradation is taking place. And coming to single axis or seasonal tracker, which kind of model would like to go ahead, depending on, of course, the cost, the area that you have, the PPA that you agreed with. The slide, this diagram which I want to show you is for a PPA of 4 rupees 34 paisa. If my cost of cleaning each module was 65 paisa, then where do I break even? What should be my cleaning cycle? So if you can see this, it comes to around fortnightly once. The cross which is getting cut around 14th or 15th day. So I should be doing my cleaning approximately. That boils down to twice, the cycle of twice a month. In the month of November, we had carried out this drone survey. I think most of you must be interested in this, because this is a Gani plant. It's an ultra solar park. If you can see, it gives the kind of details which it can give. What is a fault? Exactly, if you see, it's a diode fault here. And exact location of the particular module, it's in block number 2. The block, each block comprises of 5 megawatt. And this is another example of where the module has gone faulty because of reverse polarity. Could be at the time of installation or after repair. This is another case of a module failure. And the overall report of the plant when it gets generated is something like this. Here you can see for the block 2, that is 5 megawatt. A particular, there are like 10 blocks like this in 50 megawatt of a plant. The module failures quantity 6, module reverse polarity 4, and so on and so forth, and hotspot 182. Primarily meaning that this is where it is likely to go faulty, or where we can expect certain faults. Coming to the risk and the challenges that we look forward, how is the module degradation, how are we going to factor this point? The spare supports, how are we going to cater for that, whether or not in the because of technology obsolescence, and whether or not we are able to efficiently manage the logistics part of it. Manpower cost is going to increase day by day, that's for sure. And whether how we're going to predict and utilize this factor to our best generation possible, because in the very near future, GESCOMs are going to ask us to predict the next day's generation as well. And of course, Mother Nature rules, and there's a photograph of Rajasthan where we had a hailstorm, and notwithstanding the heavy rains and the floods, these are all challenges. The game changer in the future would be who's the guy who does his work with the least cost per megawatt, and what are the various innovative ways you're going to come around. Let's say if you are to stop, minimize my grass cutting, how do I grow a weed? This is still in the nascent phase, we're just trying to work out, and if you can do that, it is good. What is the technology you're going to use for module cleaning? Rather than doing different things, it's better to do, how do you do the things differently? Training part, I won't like to dwell much upon this, but however, there's that Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana, there are a lot many training institutes that come up, they do give certifications as well. Coming to the opportunities part itself, the made in India, the domestic content requirement, Adani, by our target is by 2020 to generate close to 3 gigawatt of our own solar panels production, and we already broken into the 12th position, breaking into global 15 solar power developers. Because of the Prime Minister's digital drive, is it not, this is just a thought, which food for thought for everybody, if the billing is possible at every month, generate automatically and DISCOM just sends the bill, I mean our money is credited, that would be better off. Rather than what's right now happening is I need to go there, get them, both like in our case there are two agencies, do the billing cycle and then, you know, joint signatures, because it's not possible, technology is there. Then why can't we have auto billing sort of thing? Only in case of any controversy raises, then I go to them and go for a dispute or something like that. So next is, as I said, about the net-centric operations. Internet is there. It's possible, like RONC, as I spoke about, is going to be the game changer for us. And let's see how Baba Ramdev pans out. He's already in with 100 crores of rupees of investment in Noida, as you're all aware. And news like this keep coming in every other day, the increase in the duty prices. But we look at it as an opportunity rather than a this thing. And as you know, the sun shines, make hay. And it's a big cake, it's pie for everybody there. The future is bright and disruptive, whoever makes it. With that, thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Monica Rathi, and I head the business development at Mahindra Susten. As most of you would know, Mahindra Susten is into utility solar space. We have about 1.7 gigawatt of solar assets as of now. Other than the utility solar, we also are into distributed solar, where we do rooftops. And we are also a big O&M partner, so we don't just do O&M for our own plants, but we also provide these services for the third parties. Now, before I start this presentation, has anyone thought how much money a developer could lose if the PR number changes by 1%? So for example, if you are talking about 78% and that's the guaranteed PR, but what you actually get in the plant is about 77%. Any thoughts how much money on an yearly basis a developer would lose? Even at a tariff as low as 2.5 rupees. So I did some maths, and even at a 2.5 rupees tariff, it means a loss of about 80 to 85 lakhs a year for a 100 megawatt plant. And that's a pretty huge number, right? All your cash flows, all your IRR calculations goes for a toss if O&M is not done properly. This is what I want to start our session with, that O&M is very, very critical. O&M is something which is gonna last from, let's say, if the plant came into operation within first 6 to 7 months, from that 6 to 7 months up till the end of life, which could be 25 to 30 years, right? There are three levers that any solar plant has to ensure that we get the IRRs that we talked about and worked out in the financial models. First one being, the plant has to be done in a completely robust manner. So robust design is the first foundation. Quality execution becomes the second big lever. If execution is not done properly, of course, you could have a lot of defects coming up, which would show up challenges during the O&M phase. And the last one being the efficient O&M. I'm not talking about the fourth piece, which is monitoring analytics, because that's the backbone of how we do the entire calculations. If I talk about operations and maintenance, let me take a minute to break that down into what do we really mean by operations and maintenance. Operations is all about how do we ensure that we get and maximize the performance and maximize the uptime of that plant. It could mean driving towards the global or the local maxima, and I will touch upon this concept later in the slides. Second one being about maintenance. Maintenance, there is a paradigm shift. It could be a condition-based maintenance, it could be predictive, it could be preventive. So we are talking about a proactive maintenance rather than talking about a reactive maintenance where you have a shutdown. And last piece, which is analytics. There are millions and millions of data that we get from the plant every single day, be it from the combiner box, be it from the inverter, the switchyard. How do we ensure that there is enough analytics which churns out these numbers and figures out what is the best and what is the best way to optimize this plant? Let me touch the first pillar, which is the maximization of plant uptime. Now, as I said earlier, 1% reduction in PR means a lot loss of revenue. PR is a combination of a lot of parameters, and as you would know, uptime is one of the biggest contributor there. We have been seeing plant uptime in the range of 99.5% and above, and uptime could then be subdivided into, or if I look at the downtime from that perspective, we could have shutdown maintenance, which of course means that yes, there is some defect that has happened because of which you have had shutdown, and this would mean complete loss of revenue, whether it is for a particular cluster or it could be for the complete plant. The preventive maintenance is usually done late in the evening or in the low generation hours, just so as to ensure that yes, you do a health check basically for the entire plant so that you are able to get the maximum generation later. And last one being predictive maintenance. This is where the future is. This is where you are looking at one cluster and comparing it with the performance of the other cluster and saying both the parameters are same, both the clusters are same, the inverters are same. So why is that this inverter is giving me a better efficiency compared to the other inverter, right? It is still, there is no maintenance required per se, right? It's just looking at that global maxima from a perspective of optimizing the entire plant. Getting to the root cause of, oh, maybe for this inverter, the temperature rise in this inverter is higher than the others. Then getting further down, is the temperature rise because of the inverter itself, or is there something happening at the combiner box level or at the module level because of which you are getting lower efficiencies? So that's what this predictive maintenance is all about. The second key pillar is maximizing the plant performance. Now, we talked about solar parks. And you would be surprised to know that even in a solar park where you have multiple competitors having different plants, the performance of one plant is not exactly the same as the performance of the other plant. The irradiation is same, right? You are at the same location. More or less the technology is same if they have been constructed in the same period, be it 1000 volt or 1500 volt system. But still you see the performance differences between plants. The major difference is because of how do you go about increasing the performance of that plant by doing a proper maintenance and operation of that plant. When I talk about equipment benchmarking, we are not only talking about equipment benchmarking within the plant, but we are also talking about equipment benchmarking outside the plant. So you could look at that for our solar plant compared to other plants in the solar park, the performance is less. And then do a root cause analysis of why that is happening. A lot of this, of course, cannot happen manually. We would need SCADA, we would need cloud computing, we would need the IoT to be able to help us understand these performance differences. The last piece, as I said, predictive and conditional maintenance. It could mean, Mr. Reddy talked about doing an entire plant survey using drones, right? We could also look at localized surveys by doing a thermal imaging of the PV modules. It could be thermal imaging of the DP structures. We also have a PV lab, and it's a mobile PV lab, which could help you do EL testing and flash testing right there on the ground. Rather than waiting for us to send the modules back to the lab, this is something that you can manage at the site level itself. Now, we talked about operations and maintenance. What are the major challenges that an O&M provider has at site? It is not just the technology challenges. The challenges could be local issues. We have all heard about vandalisms and thefts. We have all heard about fires in the plant. For one of the plant, I still remember, the fire had come up just because of the fact that the security guard who was sitting there, he was feeling cold and he just wanted a little bit of warmth for himself. Now you can't really stop some of these challenges. What is really required in this scenario is experience. Experience of your O&M partner who knows and understands how to train the manpower who is at site and how to ensure that some of these local issues are handled in a proper manner. Be it a sarpanch walking into the plant and saying that, okay, I want such money, or I'm the module cleaning, the water that you're gonna be using for module cleaning would be at a higher cost compared to the cost that you were getting earlier. So how do you manage some of these challenges become very, very critical and imperative when you are doing operations and maintenance of the plant. Grid issues, of course. We, with additional solar plants coming in, I think we have all heard about storage. There would be challenges of frequency regulation. There would be challenges of forecasting. There would be challenges of the frequency not getting matched, because of which there would be load on the grid. So how do we ensure that even with all the grid variations and instability, the liaisoning that is required with the DISCOM at that point of time is done properly to enable your O&M plan to give you the PRs and to give you the generation numbers that you had taken in the financial models. The last piece, which is critical, and I think we all heard this, the major contributor to an O&M is the manpower cost. If you see this bucket, manpower, including the site and security, contributes to almost 60% of the total cost. So could there be technology which could be used to reduce this? We have at least an internal target of talking about manless solar power plants sometime in the future. And some of the technologies which would help us is doing a remote monitoring at our remote operation center, doing drone-based analysis of the entire plant, and having a cluster-based approach within the plant. So if you have multiple plants within Karnataka, there could be one person who is stationed at one of the locations who runs to any of these sites as and when required to do any shutdown maintenance. But other than that, we are looking at how do we make the solar plants completely manless. Now, this is a typical example of a 20 megawatt plant. We are looking at, I will not talk about each of these individual pieces, but we are looking at roughly about 7.8 million data points every day coming out of this plant. So remote monitoring and control becomes very, very critical, which is where a proper SCADA is what is the need of the hour. The traditional O&M, if you would see, was all about monitoring. The new age O&M, and I would refer this to the way medical industry has moved, right? Earlier we used to talk about if there's a disease, you come up with a solution. But today we have a lot of predictive health checkups. We have a lot of analysis of how your parameters have been fluctuating up and down to be able to give you a solution for the same, which is where your entire O&M approach itself is changing. In the new age, we are talking about control through the SCADA, we are talking about optimization through the SCADA, looking at the kind of parameters that we just saw. Mahindra Susten gets a little advantage here because we have our own in-house SCADA system, which is called Machine Pulse or Solar Pulse. Again, we have a portfolio of about 1.5 gigawatt here, both internal as well as third party. This is something that I just talked about in terms of the medical analysis. So we are moving away from descriptive to diagnostic to a prescriptive analysis, right? And this is how you will be able to optimize the entire solar plant by integrating the various parameters. Now let me take a sample case study of what could cause underperformance. And we are talking about underperformance of modules here. So I'm not sure if there are any manufacturers sitting here who would probably say that, okay, snail trail doesn't really have an impact on the performance of the plant. But we have at least seen some of these like micro cracks, snail trails, over a period of time do impact the performance of the modules. For thin film, we are even talking about hot spots and active area corrosions. Practically speaking, if I have to identify any of these faults, look at the cycle with which we will be able to identify. So we started with, let's say this plant is commissioned in March 14. This is a typical example. By April 14 or May, you started realizing that the degradation is, or the performance is not at the level that you would have wanted it to be, right? But there is no way to pinpoint at it still. Somewhere around August, you start doing some UL testing to figure out the performance. Then that module where you had identified that, yes, there's a micro crack or this module is underperforming, you sent it to a UL lab, get it tested. You go back to the manufacturer, show him all the data. And by the time it is December or Feb, you actually are able to get that warranty claim. So we are talking about a cycle of almost 12 months to 14 months to be able to even predict that your module is not performing up to its level and to be able to get a warranty claim on that. What is going to be critical in future, where we are talking about 100 mega, I mean the plant size, the average plant size that we are looking at today is 100 megawatt. How do we reduce this cycle? One of the solution is having a PV mobile lab. This is one of its kind. It's a mobile lab which can go from one location to the other. It carries a EL tester, it carries a flash tester. The NABL accreditation is still ongoing, but once it is accredited, you don't need to wait for the modules to be sent back to the labs. You could do the entire testing right there on the ground and go to the module manufacturer saying that this was the degradation number that was promised and this is what I am getting. So this is how we will have to build. This is one of the labs that we have from Susten, but I think this is the kind of infrastructure that we need to build to be able to get the O&M optimizations as we would require in the future. Again, another example of a control center. This is the central command center that runs 18/7 at our Susten office in Mumbai. The way this helps is, of course, we have experts sitting here in the remote center, so I don't need the same expert sitting at the site. They are able to do remote troubleshooting and then guide people at site that this is what might have gone wrong, why don't you change, or why don't you do these actions to be able to get the plant up and running. I'll just take a minute to talk about Susten's capability here on this slide. Some of the services, as I said, we provide is having our own SCADA system, which is Solar Pulse. We do have in-house field testing teams, which are, you of course get the advantage of having the PV lab, as well as we help analyze a lot of developers when they're trying to buy or acquire already existing assets. What is the kind of performance that you are getting from this asset and what are the different ways to optimize? So that is another service that we provide. We do have the drone with thermal camera to be able to do the kind of analysis that Mr. Reddy had just shown. And of course the power quality analyzers. So with this, I end.